So investment terms, making sure you define those investment terms and manage the expectations of your investors. You know, if you're going out and being careful with them and providing them with that disclosure and telling them, hey, you know, we're having some issues right now, you know, some delays, or hey, the market's turned over and you know, we're not going to be able to sell. You know, it's just human nature. I think people don't like to be surprised, particularly with bad news. Maybe, you know, easing them into it a little bit makes it a little more easy to bear. But again, just that disclosure is so important. Again, you know, you're using other people's money, and they get angry when they lose their money. Inadequate ongoing accounting, financial reporting, you know, so this is really key when you're taking in other people's money. It's a relationship, it's a marriage. And every year you have to go to your accountant and say, hey, let's make sure we get their K-1s out. So, and for those of you that don't know what that is that's a report of the partnership to the partner. They take that and then they put all of that, they report all of that income that they derive from the partnership from their investment onto their 1040 Schedule K-1. But you have to hire an accountant to do that, unless you're an accountant or unless you're a whiz with that. You know, you can maybe do it yourself, but that's ongoing reporting. It's super important. If you don't do it, you're going to get sued. And so this is maybe one of the really key point. You know, so failure to understand consequences of violating securities laws, and that's what I'm telling you about tonight. Not only, you know, so you get sued for securities fraud. I told you I was going to go out and build this apartment complex, but I really spent it on whiskey and women. And so you sued me now. The remedy that you have and that I'm liable for is to give you your money back plus a statutory rate of interest. And usually it's like, I don't know what it is now, but it's pretty low, maybe like 6-8%. But that's a bad penalty, because what's happened is I've spent all your money on, you know, not the apartment project. And I owe you personally, I'm personally liable now for that money. And it's called rescission. It's as if the investment never happened. You got your money back in your pocket, and back there when you initially made it, you put it, instead of giving it to me, you put it into a bank account and you earn 6-8% a year. That's what rescission is saying. And that's a really bad result, particularly if I don't have any money and no asset. You know, if you have the dirt, you know, at least you can sell that and maybe repay some of your investors. But if you have a piece of software, maybe not so easily done. So no general solicitation. We talked about that. Finders. You know, this is something that always comes up. Hey, you know, Roland, I hear you're starting this new company. You're offering $1 million. You're doing $1 million raise. I've got this buddy. He'll invest $100,000 with you, and I'll introduce him to you. But you know, pay me 7% of that amount. It's a very typical, not unusual arrangement at all. You know, some of the biggest investment banks do it all the time. But the difference between me and my friend and the investment banks is that they're registered broker-dealers, and I'm just some dude with a rich friend. And there are disclosure requirements in connection with that, and again, these investor protection rules. There are exemptions, though, and so if you want to enter into that kind of arrangement and you're willing to just stand back and make the introduction and do no more, there's a specific way that you can do that in Texas, and I can talk with you about that. But this is an area that you have to be really careful with. I think I picked up the wrong one. So I guess that's the end of it, and there's my contact information. Like I said, I'd love to hear from anybody with questions. You know, I'll talk to you on the phone. If it gets more involved, I might say, hey, you know, this is pretty complicated. I'm starting to give you legal advice. I'm going to need to put you on the clock. But you know, initial phone call, I'm more than happy to answer any questions. And I'm a strong believer in the notion that there aren't any dumb questions. There are lots of inquisitive idiots, but no dumb questions. And so open it up now. And I saw... Yes, sir.
I have a question about the legal entity.
Right.
Is there a limit... to the number of properties I can own in a sub-series of my Texas Series LLC before I lose the insulation?
Right. So brought up a really good question about a new type of entity over the last few years, and it's called a Series LLC. An LLC is a limited liability company, and it's in a business or a business entity, just like a corporation or a limited partnership, and you form it pursuant to state laws. So I can form a Texas LLC, or I could form a Louisiana LLC. All the states have them now. And there are different reasons why you choose one jurisdiction over another, but like I said, for a real estate investment deal here in Austin, in Texas, you use a Texas LLC, but this new type of LLC is called a Series LLC, and what you can do with a Series LLC is you have to make a specific designation in your certificate of formation, so it's like putting everybody on notice that you have a Series LLC, and what you can do with that now is you can slice that LLC up into many different companies, in fact, and into series. And each series has its own employee identification number. And what you're supposed to do is segregate assets specifically to that series. And so what you've done is you've got Series A of, you know, Roland LLC, and it holds, you know, it owns this house, that single, you know, whatever, that single asset. And then I do another deal, and then I'm able to form another LLC. I obtain an EIN for that, not another LLC, another series for the next asset. I obtain a different EIN for that series and keep different books and records. And so the idea is, you know, if I have one LLC and I own two real estate investments, if I have a slip and fall over here and horrible injury, whatever it is, and they sue me for that injury, you know, remember what I said at the beginning, I'm only liable for the assets that I've contributed to the business entity.
Sorry, can I have Sean Connolly? Thank you.
I'm only liable for the assets that I've contributed to the business entity, but what's happened now is, you know, nothing's happened over here. This one's great, but the slip and fall happened over at this property. That person's going to sue the entity, and they can get at any assets that the entity owns. And so in the past, before Series LLC, I would say, okay, for asset one, have LLC one own that. For asset two, have LLC two own that. So you have two separate LLCs. The Series LLC just kind of acknowledges this idea that you don't have to create all these entities. You can just keep different books and records, and as long as you satisfy some certain minimal requirements with the state of Texas and documenting this and you know, keep things separate, then we're going to treat each one of your series as a separate entity. And it really is. You know, it has its own EIN number, own tax identification number, and the question was, is there a limit to the number of properties you can have in one of the series? And the answer is no, because it's just like an LLC. You could have, you know, however many properties you would want to own by that LLC. And there are reasons for doing that. You know, you may be insured, you know, you cover your risk of loss through insurance. But my series can own multiple properties, but the answer is you just have to look at it on a case-by-case basis. I don't know. I mean, you know, you may have a bank, maybe with a cross-collateralization requirement. So the borrower is the series, and they want, you're going to give them a security interest in the two both properties. You know, you're getting a loan against one, but then you're going to give them a security interest in the other, and they require it to be both under the same series, and you just acknowledge, okay, there's a risk that, you know, a creditor can get all these assets in the series, but I'm just going to take that risk because if I don't do it, then the bank's not going to give me the financing. So that's maybe one instance where, I mean, you know, they could do that with a separate entity. So, just holding multiple assets in a single entity, you have to acknowledge that they're all those assets, whether they're owned by a single entity or a series LLC, they're all subject to creditors' claims of that entity or the series. I mean, that's just the general principle. Yes, ma'am.
So I'm my understanding is like, if I want to do investment, and I can do investment, if I want to own a Tony, like, a bar downtown 6th Street, it's just like something like that. Like, I have a whole bunch of projects just underneath one name, correct?
Well, so the name, you know, you have to name the LLC something. So Yolanda, you know, we'll just call it Yolanda LLC. But you're going to put on notice in the certificate of formation that you filed that it's a series LLC, and then that puts everybody on notice that you're going to slice it up into these different series. And so each series would have its own name, but it's each series, it's a series of Yolanda LLC.
That's pretty much what it is. Like, yeah. I'm not stuck. Like LLC is limited. I'm not stuck into one thing. I can just do a whole bunch of different little small projects, but still underneath both.
Right. Okay. Yeah, that's right. And as long as you keep your records, keep good records, and segregate the assets, then you know you have that protection from holding all the assets in one entity or one series.
Jordan? Yes, can I call Zach? Paul?
Sir.
So, if you have a corporation and then you form the LLC in the corporation, you would say, okay, let's do this thing, and then the EA for the
company. Yeah, exactly. And that's really the only, you know, you do this kind of by, you just decide, hey, I'm going to create.